All right, so confession number one. I actually wasn't on the original Eclipse development team. I was actually on the Visual Age for Java development team. Who's old enough to remember Visual Age for Java? I'm so sorry. But Danny's, who's doing one of the next talks, has been on the team since the very, very beginning. But actually, the story goes back a little bit farther than that. I was actually I was employee number 12 at this little company called OTI that IBM acquired in 1996, and that's the team that eventually became the Eclipse team. So I do have very, very long roots with the community and with the group of people that have built Eclipse, and I've been with the Eclipse Foundation as its executive director since the very beginning. So it's been over 12 years now at the helm of Eclipse. So before I get started, I just wanted to say, first of all, thank you, Naresh, for organizing the first official Eclipse Summit India. Really appreciate it. And thank you to ConfEngine for all the work that you did to putting on the event. And thank you to Bosch for being the anchor sponsor for the event. Really appreciate the support. And looking forward to the next couple of days. I'm going to be around and actually attending as many of the talks as I can. So if you have any questions, if you ever see me in the hallway and you want to ask a question about what's going on at Eclipse or whatever, always happy to talk. Just stop me and, you know, let's grab a coffee or a beer and have a chat. So always happy to do that. So, all right. So my talk, I do a lot of talks. In case you haven't figured that out, I basically talk professionally. So I could do all kinds of talks, but I decided I wanted to do something a little bit different. I mean, I can talk about Eclipse, I can talk about Eclipse tools, I can talk about, you know, all kinds of industry strategy stuff, but I decided that I'd sort of change gears a little bit and kind of focus this talk mostly on what we have going on in IoT. And if for no other reason, then I keep trying to beat that drum educate people that Eclipse, the Eclipse community, the Eclipse Foundation, is doing more than the original Eclipse Java IDE. For those, you know, we still have that sort of mental picture. I'm sure if you go to your manager and say Eclipse, he thinks of an IDE, not a, you know, 340 project community doing all kinds of cool and different stuff. Not that the IDE isn't cool, not that the IDE isn't great, it's just that it's not the only thing that we do. So with that, first a very, very brief quick word about sort of our sponsor, the Eclipse Foundation, that hangs all this together, just to try to give you a scale of the organization and of what we do and how we do it. So the foundation itself is basically a small business. We have $5 million budget, we have 30 people around the world, about a third of those people are now in Europe. We have about 240 members, 13 of those are strategic, so they're on our board of directors. We run a lot of events, four major conferences, a whole bunch of Eclipse days, a whole bunch of demo camps and the like. So we're very busy around the world. And we have 8 collaborative working groups that I'm not going to talk too much about, but those are sort of one of the vehicles that we use to get Eclipse, the Eclipse community, into brand new areas. Actually, we just announced stood one up last week called Open Pass, which is Volkswagen, Daimler and BMW collaborating together on building simulation engines for testing autonomous driving systems, which is actually, I think, pretty darn cool. There's sort of your eyeball chart with all the logos. You don't have to memorize this or anything like that. But the community is really what drives Eclipse. And so we're up, I keep missing that number. It's constantly updating. I think we're actually around 340 projects at Eclipse now. Roughly every year at Eclipse, there's about 130 million lines of code that are flowing through our Git repository. So it's a very busy place. It's not a quiet place at all. We have just under 1,200 committers. Lots of active users of the Eclipse IDE and the various IDEs, Java, C++, PHP, and the like. We do a lot of downloads, and we have a very busy website. So Eclipse, from one perspective, is this sort of very interesting thing, just when you think about the fact that you've got this much activity going on with such a small team at the center of it, running the community and helping the community out. I think that's actually a pretty interesting, new and interesting way of doing business and building and supporting communities. All right, so now to the main event, to the talk. And part of the reason why I like doing this talk is because some days I think of, they shouldn't call it the Internet of Things, they should call it the Internet of Greed, right? I mean, there's all these quotes about how much money there is sloshing around in the Internet of Things and what a big opportunity it is, to the point where it's like, you know, every carpetbagger, shyster, you know, Silicon Valley latte sipping hipster is now doing IoT, right? Because of course it's easy. I think that actually though that in a couple of years, we're not even going to talk about the Internet of Things. It's not going to be the Internet of Things. In a few years, what we're going to call the Internet of Things is the Internet, right? It's just going to be part of the fabric of what's around us, just like the Internet is today. It's just that we're going to be used to having a whole lot more sensors and a whole lot more sort of real-time data about what's going on around us and going on around the world. Of course, the challenge for doing this is to maintain our privacy and individuality while all of that's going on, but that's another talk. And the basic premise of my talk is that the Internet of Things is going to be built on open source. And the first thing to understand about why that is when, and this is like the very, very common mistake, is the Internet of Things is not a market. It's not, you're not going to go to somebody and sell them the Internet of Things. You're going to go and sell them a fitness solution. You're going to go sell a logistics company a monitoring solution. You're going to go sell a factory, you know, better monitoring and real-time control systems that are available from around anywhere around the world with the right security credentials. So the Internet of Things is like the Internet today. It's not a market in and of itself. It's an enabling technology that people can build new solutions for markets. So when I say the Internet of Things will be built on open source, that doesn't mean that people are not, doesn't mean that there won't be companies and people who are going to make a lot of money building solutions for customers in markets using the Internet of Things. That's not what I'm saying. But what I am saying is that the very basic plumbing, the basic infrastructure of the Internet of Things is going to be based on open source. And there's five good reasons why that's true. The first is just the sheer scale, right? We're talking about tens, 20s, maybe eventually hundreds of billions of devices. If you start charging money for the software that starts going on those devices, even if it's a couple of pennies, right, you're never going to be able to scale the Internet of Things the way people are talking about. And this is exactly analogous to what we saw sort of on the server side with the Internet itself. If you look at all the big successful Internet companies like, you know, Google and Facebook and Twitter, all of their infrastructure, the stuff that they need to scale effortlessly, is based on open source. Google would have never been able to get off the ground if they had to pay Microsoft money for every individual server they were putting into their data centers. That would never work. And so for the same reason, you're going to see the scalability is going to drive open source into the devices, because it has to. Anybody who comes up with a business model that says they're going to put a tax on every device is going to eventually lose out to somebody else who has a business model where the software that goes on the device is free. And so that's why the software has to be free and open source. The next good reason is innovation. And what I mean by that is, and the reason why that's true is that what we have really learned over the last 10 years, and this is part of the reason why the Silicon Valley companies are so successful, is that companies or organizations that use open source as the building blocks for their solutions can move faster, do more interesting things at a lower cost than anybody who tries to build it all themselves, right? So, and the reason, main reason why that's true is that open source allows this idea of permissionless innovation. One of the great things that you have now as a developer is that you do not have to ask permission to mash up some different pieces of software together to see if you can use them in a new solution. You just go ahead and try it. I know it's really hard to put your mind back in history, and I'm really old, but when I started in the IT industry, I was an application developer for Nortel at the time. And when we wanted to install new IT infrastructure, we had to sign a non-disclosure agreement, we had to get a trial evaluation copy of the software, we had to hire consultants to do a proof of concept. It was like a 6-month, highly confidential effort just to find out if the junk works, right? Compare that to what you have today with the rate of experimentation that open source gives you. You can try things out, download, cobble it together. Is there a hope this is ever going to work? And get your answer in an afternoon, right? Compare that to what we had, you know, 20, 30 years ago. I mean, this is the best time to be a developer. It's like instant gratification for developers. You get to try it out and see if it works, right? Without actually having to ask the pointy-haired boss or anybody else for permission. So that high level of experimentation is a huge part of why open source-based solutions are always going to out-innovate the proprietary stacks. Interoperability is the next one. Standards are awesome. And, you know, everybody should have their own. Or the other great expression I heard is, you know, standards are like toothbrushes. Everybody wants one, but they want their very own. Right? It's but let's face it, standards are going to be a very big part of the Internet of Things. The where open source starts to play in that is that once you have a standard, one of the best things you can do to make sure that A, that standard is successful, and B, that that standard achieves very high rates of adoption, is to provide a good, solid, reliable open source implementation for that standard. And where that really helps take off with a new standard is around interoperability. If companies can come together and all basically share the same implementation of a standard, and the cost of that implementation is something close to zero, or in the worst case, shared amongst the companies that are implementing it, you are going to save a ton of time to market and money in getting that standard going. And that's why things like you see CoAP and lightweight M2M and MQTT and these standards that are helping drive the IoT, open source implementations and at Eclipse are really, really very much part of that. The next reason why open source is going to win in the IoT is just the sheer number of developers that need to be recruited and trained and enabled for the IoT. I haven't seen a better visual than this. This is now, I think, 2 years old. But ultimately, what these guys, Vision Mobile, were saying is that between 2014 and 2020, which is like, what, 6 years, 7 years, we have to recruit 4.2 million developers for the Internet of Things. Now, not all of those are going to be sort of device developers, but they're going to have to at least have some kind of understanding about what devices are and what the different, you know, the difference between life cycles between devices and open source and web development. But you know, when you talk about recruiting, enabling, training 4 million developers, The only way you're going to be able to do that is if the tools and the basic frameworks and the infrastructure that they're working on is based on open source. You know, even if you try to put in a model, you know, it used to be for years and years, if you had a developer, you had to give them $3,000 to $5,000 worth of software development tools on their desktop before they could get to work. Right? Now, the expectation, and part of the reason why this is true is Eclipse itself. Big part of the expectation is when you get a developer going, the cost to kit out that developer to become productive is as close to zero as possible. And that has to be when you're, again, this is sort of back to scale, but this is people scale, not device scale. Just outfitting 4 million developers over a couple of years, if the software tools are not free, is going to be a major impediment to growth. And the next part that developers have to play is that the world is different now, again, from the one that I grew up in, because of the way that technology is chosen. It used to be that technology was chosen. If you were a large company, you did these proof of concepts I was talking about earlier, and your managers would decide which technology solution was picked. Nowadays, technology is effectively chosen by you people, by the developers, by doing your experimentation, proving out which solution works, making the technology choices based on open source, integrating open source solutions. And one of the most, and it's fairly old now, but this trend first became observable in the battles that happened towards the second half of the last decade around SOA. So if you were around, say, 2007, all of your IT magazines had names like Programmable Web, right? Or Web 2.0, right? And the interesting thing was you had two major technology choices. You had the one that was developed and backed by all the vendors, right? SOA, right? They had a whole standards organization called OASIS for it. There was Microsoft, there was IBM, there was Oracle, there was SAP. Every single major enterprise IT vendor told the world that SOA was the way that the programmable web was going to happen. In competition, right? You had a guy named Roy Fielding that wrote a PhD thesis on this thing called REST. And he had one advantage that all of those enterprise software companies didn't have, which was he was one of the leaders and committers on the Apache web server project. And he put his REST work into the Apache web server. So now you had this competing technology that was A, way simpler, B, already running on the web server you had deployed in your business, and C, probably better documented. So developers voted with their feet. And this is even to this day, the best example where you really see this departure between what the industry told the developers, this is the way it's going to be, kids, and what the developers did to them by choosing the other technology. And this is now, there's a whole book on this called The New Kingmakers that talks about the fact that technology choices are now made by developers, not by managers. And I think that's the other major influence why developers are going to pick IoT infrastructure solutions that are going to be based on open source, not on what the vendor tries to push in their direction. And a great current example of this is MQTT. So MQTT actually was around for first developed around 2000 or something. It's been around for a long, long, long time. And it was sort of a curiosity. Not many people used it. And then it's open source there. And by the way, I did this screenshot a little while ago. If anything, this line is getting more vertical. And so the MQTT, in terms of its adoption as an open source solution for doing IoT protocol, it just really demonstrates how developers are voting with their feet. And the last, and frankly, probably the most important reason why the Internet of Things is going to be based on open source is because there's no money in software anymore. Business models today are not based on charging money for software licenses. So this is actually from the US Bureau of Economic Analysis, and it tracked the average per unit cost of software since 1980 to, this was published in December 14. And it's about as asymptotically close to zero as you can get, right? Now, I'm sure open source had some overarching influence on that, but the main message is that the business models that we saw for so long, whether it was shrink wrap or enterprise, the idea that you would buy a software license and that was the way the companies producing the software were going to make their money, that those business models are now dead. And in the concept of Internet of Things, there's a whole bunch of different taglines. I'm sure you've all heard of them. Internet of Everything. But one of my own personal favorites is the one that Bosch uses, which is the Internet of Things and Services. Because that's actually, I think, a pretty good description of where the money is going to be in the Internet of Things. You're going to make money selling things, and you're going to make money selling services. Anybody who tries to make money selling software that goes on devices is going to be dead before they even get out of the starting gate. No one is going to actually participate with a vendor that tries to build a business model like that. And so economics is great. It helps drive human behavior. And the fact that there's simply no money in software is definitely going to influence how the Internet of Things pans out. All right, so that's sort of the top sort of five reasons why I think the IoT is going to be based on open source. The rest is I wanted to talk about is, okay, so what's Eclipse doing about it? And so we started this off 4 years ago now? 4 years ago? November? End of 2011. Almost coming up on 5 years. Time flies. And the idea was to create an Eclipse-style platform and ecosystem play in the Internet of Things. So there's really the three main areas that we're playing in is open IoT development tools, communication protocols, and then application frameworks and runtimes. And in the world of application frameworks and runtimes, one of the things that's happened over the last 18 months that's very, very different is when we first got started, when we talked about frameworks and runtimes, it was stuff that ran on devices or device gateways. And now what's happening is a lot of the new projects that we're getting in Eclipse IoT are more focused on the cloud infrastructure that you need. So we are truly building out an end-to-end solution that goes right from the smallest of devices right through into the largest of cloud infrastructures, whether it's public or private. So on development tools, we got actually lots of things going on. Of course, Eclipse JDT gets used a ton. Doesn't everybody use JDT? Then there's also, it's kind of misnamed now, but it's the Java ME tools. So it was originally called mobile tools for Java, although I don't think anybody uses Java ME for mobile anymore. But it is an up-to-date implementation for Eclipse tools for the current version of Java ME. Eclipse CDT, and one of the things that's really kind of fun is that Doug Schaefer, who's the leader of the CDT project, or the co-leader of the CDT project, decided that he liked playing with Arduinos. But he really, really hated the Arduino Sketch tool as a way to build software for it. So he's actually built this package called the Eclipse CDT for Arduino that you can get on Marketplace that basically gives you a complete out-of-box Eclipse experience for building for the Arduino, which is kind of fun. Orion, anybody who saw me talk last year probably saw me, you know, hacking code at my cottage from the stage with Orion. So Orion is a web-based tool for being able to develop code directly from your browser. So rather than a desktop IDE, more of a browser-based IDE, it works particularly well with languages like JavaScript and Node.js. So But one of the things that's kind of fun is you can easily install Orion on a device gateway class machine like a Raspberry Pi, even an old Raspberry Pi 1, it works fine. And you can hack code from your browser directly on your device. Eclipse Che is sort of a very new and interesting platform at Eclipse that's does a lot of, gives you a very complete IDE that runs in your browser, with particular focus on doing great language support for Java. And it works extremely well with Docker. So you can basically build your workspaces as Docker containers. But the Eclipse Che team worked with Samsung so that Che is actually the IDE for Samsung's board in the IoT, certainly in the makerspace called the Arctic. So the Samsung Arctic IDE is entirely based on Che. And then finally, PolarSys. So PolarSys is one of the working groups that we have at Eclipse. You can find it at polarsys.org. And they are building out a complete tool set for model-based embedded systems development. And so these are sort of much more like the tool chains that you would get in sort of large industrials and the use of for building sort of safety critical or functional safety requirements or software that has functional safety requirements. But they have a new project that's actually pretty cool that's just getting up called the PolarSys Rover project, where they're demoing how you can put together a complete PolarSys tool chain for doing model-based development for a rover. So you sit there and you work in the graphical development environment, it generates some code, then you can add some additional code through the editor, but then you deploy it to the rover and you can teach the rover to do new tricks. It's actually pretty fun. And they've got a good description of what you need to go buy. I think the rover and all of the sensors and kit that you need to buy is about, I think, something like $200 or $250, which for a rover is actually not bad. So what we're trying to do at Eclipse is to really solve this whole problem around open standards and open source to connect and manage. And managing is one of the big problems that certainly a lot of people don't really spend a lot of time thinking about when you're talking about sort of toy applications of IoT. And I said earlier that Eclipse is starting to get more into doing complete infrastructure from the device all the way to the cloud. But to be really clear, we're not talking about building cloud containers ourselves, right? So at some point, we're going to hit either Cloud Foundry or OpenShift or Kubernetes, you know, some infrastructure that's either publicly hosted or hosted or privately hosted. We're not replicating that. However, just to pick on Cloud Foundry, for example, up until very recently, the only way you could talk to a Cloud Foundry was through port 80. So it didn't have support for any of the other protocols. You know, TCP has actually been pretty popular for a while. So being able to add support in Cloud Foundry for other protocols was a thing that GE worked on making happen at Cloud Foundry, and has helped enable a lot of more infrastructure at Eclipse that we can now work with Cloud Foundry. So when I say that at Eclipse, we're basically talking about all of the stuff right from the device to the point where we actually get to the cloud container, if you will, whether that's something like OpenShift or Cloud Foundry or whatever. And as you can imagine, that still leaves a lot of room for a lot of technology. There is a lot of stuff that needs to be required before you can provide a complete solution for that. And to give you, I'm not talking about the devices, device gateways, and the internet and the various protocols, because Benjamin Cabé is doing an IoT talk in the very next time slot. So if you want to get a deep dive into that stuff, I strongly suggest you go and see Benjamin's talk. But just to give you a flavor of a couple of the new projects that we've got coming, yeah, I know this is an eyeball chart. That says IoT connector in the middle. The Eclipse Hano project was started by Bosch, and there's now Red Hat committers on it as well. And really, the idea behind Eclipse Hano is to provide the ability to route telemetry data from the device through to the application that's looking for that telemetry data. Like, just think of it, try to walk through a sort of a simple example. In a world where you have a single cloud instance that's running 30 IoT applications, and you've got on the deployed out in the world, say 1 million sensors with 100,000 device gateways, right? And some device gateway says, here's some data. The temperature is now 20 degrees. How do you figure out which application cares that that particular device gateway is giving you that particular value and interpreting that 20 is actually meant to be a temperature, right? So the whole routing problem of matching up devices and applications with the telemetry data that's flowing northbound is absolutely a big issue. And then the other way is device command and control, right? If you want to update the software, provision new versions of software on devices, or just even tell devices to reboot or whatever, there has to be a southbound way where from the cloud infrastructure, you push out updates to the devices that need to be updated. So Hano is helping solve this problem by providing uniform remote service interface, routing of both telemetry and control data, along with standard service interfaces for managing identity and access control. Then Eclipse Kapua, which is just getting started now, and so it's just been proposed, it's been created, but the code's not in there yet. It's coming, I think, in September, so roughly a month from now, is a really ambitious project that is providing a cloud integration platform for IoT. So multi-protocol connectivity, device management, telemetry data pipeline, abilities to have multi-tenant applications, all this kind of infrastructure for building IoT applications. And again, the idea is that Kapua is going to run on top of Cloud Foundry, and it provides you with a set of frameworks for building your IoT application. So if Cloud Foundry is the container, Kapua is the set of frameworks that will help you build your IoT application, and they're both going to run in your Cloud Foundry container. And Hano and Kapua are complementary to one another. So the idea is that Hano is going to do this routing, right, when it's looking for an application that needs to find the telemetry data, right? What it will be talking to is an application that's built on top of Kapua, with all of the frameworks and so on that are there. So the idea is that we're building out this infrastructure that gives you the pieces that you need to go from northbound from the device gateway all the way through to your running cloud. These projects are primarily being supported by Bosch, by Red Hat, and in particular Kapua by a company called Eurotech. All of these companies certainly Bosch and Red Hat, everybody has heard of. Eurotech, one of the nice things about Eurotech is it's a relatively small company. They come primarily from a hardware background, but they've actually been doing this kind of technology for a decade. So they were one of the original co-authors of the MQTT standard. It was Eurotech and IBM were the two authors of the first version of MQTT. And Eurotech has been doing device management at cloud scale, you know, back when it was called M2M rather than IoT, but they've been doing this for a great many years, and they have a lot of great experience on how to put this together. So that's some of the sort of technologies that we've got going. So how are we doing on things like industry adoption? So Eclipse IoT is primarily focused on implementing standards, and particularly standards for protocols, services, and frameworks. And this is the landing page for the IoT working group. If you're at all interested in IoT and you haven't been there, you should definitely drop by. There's a lot of really cool stuff there. We're up to 25 members or something. I can never keep track. But there's definitely some. It's a great mix of massive companies, middle-sized companies and smaller companies, and very innovative companies. So you've got the likes of Siemens and Bosch and Deutsche Telekom mixed in with enterprise IT vendors like Red Hat and IBM, and you've got and Canonical, and you've got then a lot of smaller sort of startups like Gadget Keeper and I imagine you get Gadget Keeper on there twice. Attaboy. And then you got other sort of medium-sized equipment companies like Sierra Wireless and the like. So it's a really good mix of different sizes of companies with particular with different technology and expertise to offer to the group. In terms of adoption, one of the highlights for us is if you look out there at what's running today, what does Azure, AWS, and the Watson IoT platform all have in common? And that's Eclipse PAHO. Every single one of these IoT cloud infrastructures are using PAHO as their MQTT client. And in a few cases, not all of them, but in a few cases, they're using the Eclipse Mosquito project as well for their, for at least their starting point for processing MQTT messages on the server. This is a great example of where having PAHO, which is a project that implements the MQTT client side in a wide variety of programming languages, has really helped enable MQTT to take off. And with this kind of adoption, it's been great to see. Another great example of adoption in industry is, and I haven't touched on this project, I think Benjamin will at least mention it in passing, is the Eclipse NeoScada, which is an open source product for doing factory automation. So they're actually using it to help manage their smart grids. So it's another great industry adoption story. Smart Home, Eclipse Smart Home, is used by Deutsche Telekom in their Quivicon platform. It's used by the core for the OpenHAB community. ProSyst is using it now for extending their home automation solutions. Alcon and Yetu are two others that are also using Eclipse Smart Home. So we're starting to see that getting adopted into products as well. The Leshen project is an Eclipse open source project that does an implementation of this device management protocol called Lightweight M2M. And this screenshot here is actually from the live, or one day, the live sandbox that we run at eclipse.org. So if you go to iot.eclipse.org, port number whatever, I can't remember what the Lightweight M2M one is, you actually find a running Leshen server that you can try out in your trial applications. Similarly, we have one for MQTT and others. But so what do we learn? We can learn that apparently somebody at GE is trying out Lightweight M2M on eclipse.org on that particular day. The two companies that are supporting the Leshen project are Bosch and Sierra Wireless, and OMA is the standards body that the Lightweight M2M protocol comes from. All right, switching gears again, let's talk a little bit about the community that we've now built at Eclipse around IoT. So in Eclipse IoT, and again, it's relatively new. We started off with two projects back 5 years ago. We're up to 25 projects now. And we've had a steadily increasing growth rate in terms of the number of projects. But we have 2.2 million lines of code. We have 170 active developers. And 100K downloads a month. So it's a very, very active community. So it's great to see that continue to grow. These are the sandboxes that I mentioned earlier. So if you're interested in building a trial application and you want to try out MQTT, rather than standing up your own server, iot.eclipse.org:1883, and there you've got an MQTT server that you can use. There's also sandbox for CoAP and Lightweight M2M as well. So if you're interested, you can look at that URL. And by the way, I'll certainly make these slides available. One of the other things that Benjamin and the rest of the IoT team have worked on for the last 2 years in a row is they've run this open IoT challenge. It's been a huge success where we get people to try out Eclipse IoT technologies and build solutions and compete for over $20,000 in prizes. And the winner this year was right here from Bangalore. So the IoT, I'm going to totally not pronounce that right, Vidya project allows for the ability for patients that are in rural settings to sort of collect data that they can send to a doctor. So there's a temperature sensor here, there's a heart rate monitor, ECG, so you can hook up, so I guess somebody would have to tell you how to hook it up, but you can hook up an ECG, and the Raspberry Pi collects all of the data and then transmits it to a doctor so they can tell you, don't worry, you'll be fine, or we hope. So it was a great application. It used Eclipse Cura, it used Paho, it uses Mosquito. Plus they use BitReactive, which is not open source, but it's an IoT programming tool from one of our member companies that's involved in IoT. So this is the winner last year. I can't remember exactly what the prizes that they got, but they were quite substantial. And they did a really great series of blog posts on what they were building and why they were building it and how they went about doing it. It was really extremely well done. We also do a virtual IoT meetup. So every 2 weeks we have a webinar with IoT experts. There's 800 members of this virtual meetup. And so if you're interested in joining, and just to give you some example, this is the some of the videos that have been made through the on our YouTube channel as well. So if you're looking for content on how you can do stuff with Eclipse IoT, if you go to the YouTube channel, it's got a lot of really, really great great content. Each one of these has, you know, thousands of views. So it's a very busy place, and if you're interested in learning more, I highly encourage you to try that out. So I think that, sort of just in closing, the things that I want to highlight is that we started 5 years ago with Eclipse IoT, and it was, you know, pretty small to begin with a couple of projects. First of them, MQTT and a project called Mahini. It was based on Lua that has since actually gone away. But over those 5 years, we've actually built a very impressive portfolio of technology. We're starting to see some really great industry adoption, and we think we have a great community building up around this code. So I think it's those three things together, technology, industry adoption, and community, and a sense of community, that's going to really help drive open source as the solution for constructing the Internet of Things. So one last thought, which is, please get involved. You know, pick up and use Eclipse IoT in your technology solutions. Get involved in the community. Give us bugs. Give us fixes. Write articles. Write blogs. Get involved in the IoT challenge and try to win some great prizes. Come to events like this and others to learn more. EclipseCon Europe is the next EclipseCon, which is coming up in late October in just outside of Stuttgart in Germany. And there's going to be an Eclipse IoT day there, so there's going to be lots of great content about IoT there as well. And if you have technology that you think deserves to actually get used, then by all means, bring your project to Eclipse. We're always looking for new and interesting technologies. And with that, thank you very much, and throw the floor open to any questions you may have. Thank you. Any questions? Come on, it's always the first one. As soon as you get one question, you get 10 questions. Oh, great. Thank you. Okay. Yep.
Do you use simulators? You know, in enterprise application development, everything is resolved. You need the libraries, yep, somewhere in the back end. And it's a complete development with the live debugging ability, yep, etc. So when the device come in between, things become a little bit complicated and you need simulators. What are the challenges involved in IoT-based development in Eclipse, and what are the roadmap or what is the plan to tackle those challenges?
So first of all, there's two ways to answer the question. So not every one of the Eclipse IoT projects does anything to work with the Eclipse IDE. Some do, but many don't. So there's not this, like when I talk about Eclipse IoT, we're talking about runtimes, protocol implementations, device gateway frameworks, and so on, which are really runtime technologies, not the tools that you're used to thinking about when you say the word Eclipse. Some of the projects don't do anything to work with Eclipse, and in fact, we have some of the projects in Eclipse IoT where the developers on the project use IntelliJ as their day-to-day development tool, or VI. I mean, you know, whatever it is that they want, there's no direct tie. All that said, there are some projects that do a fairly nice job of integrating with the Eclipse IDE, and I would probably hold out the Eclipse Cura device gateway framework as probably the best example of that, because they do provide an emulator, and they also provide some really nice instructions on how to set up your Eclipse workbench. And Benjamin, correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm pretty sure they also just created an OOMF profile to make starting your setting up your Eclipse workbench for Cura like super simple. So there are some projects that are taking that extra step to make it really easy to work with the Eclipse IDE, but that's not a uniform requirement of all of the projects inside Eclipse. But yeah, I mean, Eclipse does have things like the Remote System Explorer and whatever the new one is for doing remote development that partially came from the enterprise side, but it does have some capabilities for doing remote development like that. But I think there's definitely more we can do.
Thank you very much.
Any other questions? One way back there.
Hi, Mike. This new group that we have started for connected vehicles, I think it's called the Open Pass.
Yep.
I think we have been successful in pulling the big names of the automotive industry, the who's who is there. So what are the goals? Do we really have some goals like what Google pulled off with the autonomous vehicle, or what kind of goals do
we have? Are you talking about like the technical goals for the working group, or what are our goals?
Technical or any major, what grand goals do we have?
Okay, so the question is about, I mentioned the Open Pass working group, which is a new working group we just got started around doing simulation for testing of autonomous driving systems. So I'm sure everybody's heard about all the various flavors of self-driving cars and so on. One of the things that or subtleties that a lot of people don't realize is just to give you one example, is that to have an automobile certified with an autonomous driving system of any type in Germany, you have to drive it for 100,000 kilometers on German roads before they'll certify it as safe for use in Germany. So there's really no surprise that the three companies that are starting this initiative off are BMW, Volkswagen Group, and Daimler, because they're the companies that sell the most cars in Germany, and they have this huge problem, right? You have to drive a car 100,000 kilometers with a human in the driver's seat before you can say that it's safe to use. So there's lots of technology in Open Pass, but the sort of social or business goal that they have set out is they want to reduce that 100,000 kilometers to some smaller number, let's say 50,000 kilometers, cut it in half, by demonstrating to the regulatory authorities that if you have a really, really good simulation engine and lots of simulation use cases, you can safely reduce the number of actual physical miles you have to drive the car. But to do that, what you have to do is you have to build this really large-scale simulation engine that provides and gives you the ability to create thousands, if not hundreds of thousands, even millions of use cases that you test out where, you know, here's the geographic data. I'm approaching this intersection at 75 kilometers and there's a car coming the other way that's about to burn the red light. You know, what does the car do? Right? So, you know, I'm not sure if I'm exactly answering your question, but that's the kinds of goals that the group has set out for OpenPass.
Okay, so it's mostly simulation.
Yeah. Okay. So to be really clear, it's not about building autonomous driving systems. Like personally, I think that would be really cool too, but they're not there yet.
We would love to see that too.
Yeah. I mean, as there's more pressure from disruptors like Google in the automotive space, I think the car manufacturers, the incumbents are going to start to figure out that they need to start thinking more about shared platforms for software. But I think they're still a little ways away from doing that. I think ultimately the really interesting question is, will they smarten up fast enough to survive? Because as the transition goes from everybody wanting to have a car that they drive themselves to pools or fleets of self-driving cars that you get on demand, that's going to be a huge business and social disruptor for all kinds of things over the next decade or two.
I think it's good enough now as one of the steps towards the bigger goals.
Sorry?
It's good enough for now to have this goal as one of the steps to reach the bigger goal.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
I have just one.
Yep.
So it looks like the theme is completely focused on IoT.
So it looks like what, sir?
The theme of today and Eclipse's initiatives is focused on IoT.
No, that's just what I talked about today.
Okay. What other keywords are main projects that you think will be?
So I mentioned this thing called PolarSys, which was tools for embedded software development. Okay. I mean, that working group is about the same size as IoT. They have about 20 some projects, lots of different vendors involved. So that's one. There's another one called Location Tech that you've probably never heard of that has 20 some projects that is doing geospatial stuff.
Okay.
That has, again, you know, it's very unique and different. But the other thing too is, I mean, we have not forgotten our roots in tools.
Right.
So there's still lots of investment going into the Eclipse IDE. There's lots of investment going into things like Orion and Che, which I think of as the next generation of developer tools, where you start to provide developer tools that run in the cloud. The stuff that's going on in the modeling world at Eclipse, I mean, for the people that like modeling, and not everybody does, but for those who do like modeling, Eclipse is basically the community where modeling happens, right? I mean, it's massive in its own right.
Right.
So just because I chose to talk about IoT today, please don't assume that that's all we're doing.
I know a lot of the talks are focused on IoT as well. But is there some or emphasis effort on supporting Spark and machine learning kind of technologies as well?
So you mean like Apache Spark and the big data?
Yeah.
So the short answer is at the Eclipse Foundation, not really. However, I don't know about Spark, but I know, for example, that for Hadoop, there are Eclipse plugins that they have at the Apache Hadoop project themselves, and some vendors like Hortonworks and Cloudera make Eclipse tools available for their big data. I don't know about Spark in particular, but yeah, absolutely. There's certainly interest in doing that. It's not happening. Not everything in the Eclipse ecosystem happens at the Eclipse Foundation, right? A lot of people build open source plugins and don't bother bringing them to Eclipse. They might put them on Marketplace or someplace like that.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay. How are you doing for time, Naresh? All right, we have time for one last question. Assuming we have one last question. The rest just doesn't want to come up and talk because he's up next. So come on, any last questions? Going once, going twice. All right, thank you very much.